Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to SEMA SCS with AZB, pre-seen product number 2. You know what we're going to do here. We will be summarizing that entire 25-page document that you have received as your pre-seen. We will be basically just extracting the most important pieces of information, shedding the unnecessary weight. Let's have a look. November 2020 and February 2021. SEMA SCS complete pre-seen summary. The company you have been assigned is Knowledge City Technology Park. Now, this is a very interesting business model. You are a senior manager in the finance function. And we will refer to the company as we go forward as KCTP. You fundamentally report to the board and you are also an advisor on special projects and strategic matters. KCTP is based in Adviland. Adviland is a developed country. It has a well-regulated stock exchange. The currency is A-dollars and ASX requires companies to prepare financial statements in accordance with IFRSs and has 27 technology parks spread across the country. Let's pay our attention to technology parks in Adviland. The 27 parks vary in size. Some of them are little more than large converted office blocks that offer small to medium sized spaces for software development or small laboratory and workshop requirements, whereas others are built on large campus spaces with several major units and the necessary infrastructure to support large scale activities. Now let's focus our attention toward technology parks or science parks in general. The definition says areas established for occupation by companies that wish to conduct scientific and or technological research and development. And talking about geographical elements of science parks, they usually are comprised of buildings that are used as science or engineering labs or offices used for design work or software development. They occupy large plots of land. Space between buildings to offer tenants privacy is available with the scope to extend the buildings if required, and they are located on sites that are intended to attract significant numbers of organizations. That takes us to location considerations. There are three key considerations the pre-seen presents to us. One definitely is the cost. Located on the outskirts of major cities where land prices are low. Then accessibility. Sites are generally located sufficiently close to airports, mainline railway stations and motorways for easy access. So staff, clients, partners, collaborators, all of these groups of various stakeholder groups are trying to access these locations. So we need to have good accessibility. And the third one, but a very important one for technology parks, university connection. Within the proximity of at least one major university. Most tech parks are initially established by universities themselves. So we are still talking about technology parks in general. Let's talk about the buildings. As far as the buildings are concerned, the occupancy factor, which is generally intended for sole occupancy by individual tenants. The size factor, generally large spaces. The needs aspect, they are designed to be equipped and adapted to meet a variety of different needs, and the strength aspect must be strong enough. Overall, the business aspiration of technology parks is that they should be a hub for new ideas, they should exploit synergies and offer potential for collaboration. The business model: the park offers buildings or offices for rent and offers flexibility to tenants to move to larger premises if more space is required. So this is overall what happens. It's in one sense a real estate business that offers space for rent. Then let's take a look at the facilities that the pre-seen presents to us. Usually tech parks must invest heavily in infrastructure for major tenants. There should be stable, safe and consistent electrical power. So fitting and maintaining equipment that prevents changes to the voltage and available current, distributing it safely across the campus requires more than just installing electric cables. So that is as far as the electrical power, stable and power that can support whoever the tenants are is critical for tech parks. Then there has to be high-speed data links. Site security is important, security patrols, closed circuit television monitoring, security officers to monitor building alarms and call emergency services, etc. All of these are usually available. Then there's centralized telephone and answering services. So call operators on behalf of tenants, they take calls, take messages, transfer calls, and they usually provide basic information even. And there should be sufficient car parking, something that we can't live without these days. Facilities to secure bicycles and frequent bus services from the park to local public transport hubs and airports are also provided. Now that is for the major tenants. And in addition to that, if there are small tenants, small and medium sized spaces that can be adapted and configured to meet the needs of tenants who don't need sole occupancy and created by subdividing one or more of their buildings into separate units. So that is the small tenant aspect. Now, we have been talking about tenants. Let's closely focus on tenant characteristics. Let's try and understand who these tenants are. The types of clients are usually startup companies whose founders are entrepreneurs. They are usually keen to develop an idea into a commercially viable product, generally funded by venture capitalists, usually have enough resources to sustain themselves throughout the design process, and small spaces, not sole occupancy of buildings in a convenient location with good physical security. So startup companies usually show these requirements or use these kinds of characterizations to understand themselves. Subsidiaries of major corporations are also a key group of tenants. They wish to draw upon expertise from local universities and give a design team freedom to work without distractions. Those are the two types of clients. A wide range of tenants with different areas of interest can take up space in a tech park. Engineering, ICT, biotechnology, electronics, computer science and hardware, and consulting. Consulting means tenants selling services to third parties, not directly engaged in R&D. Right, now what do tenants expect? So for tech parks, the client model is renting out space and tenants come in and take up space. What are their expectations? They're usually looking for a base from which to conduct R&D. They expect flexibility to be able to move to larger premises if needs require more space, and adaptable and equipped to meet a variety of different needs. They also are looking to enjoy the ability to interact and engage with collaborators and clients. They expect staff, collaborators and clients to have easy access, close proximity to universities, and therefore being able to consult with leading academic researchers in various fields. In addition, having access to a workforce in the form of local graduates from nearby universities, and some large corporations are looking to set up individual teams away from their main corporate R&D center. So these are various expectations from staff perspective, from connections and networking perspective, from the flexibility angle. They have a wide variety of expectations. Tenants also look to collaborate with other tenants. This can take many forms, like direct provision of paid services or natural synergies. Benefits from being associated with a location that is attractive to potentially interested parties like corporate designers, job applicants, and other professional contacts. So these are key benefit and a certain avenue that is available for tenants to collaborate with other parties. These collaborations are usually positive, despite sometimes commercial confidence can make it difficult to collaborate directly. Tenants selling services to third parties without doing their own R&D also can exist. Fellow tenants sometimes are potential clients from consultations. How important is steady and reliable electrical supply for tenants? Electrical supply, they're looking for supply that does not fluctuate in current and voltage, and safe distribution of this supply has to be there. Some tenants need to use sensitive electronic equipment that cannot withstand electric spikes. and some operate equipment that draws a significant electrical current far in excess of the standard electricity supplies, and to be able to switch them on and off without any concerns. Stable electricity, you already looked at it, but from tenants' perspectives, there are serious needs. Then high-speed data is important, collection of data from remote sources, sharing large files, organizing video conferences with HD video capabilities. All of these make high-speed data important. High levels of site security is expected. Tenants may be working on commercially sensitive new designs, and tenants could be working on government contracts, defense contracts that even involve national security. So high levels of site security, important. Administrative and other business service support, such as centralized call operator support to focus attention on R&D work. And even convenience for staff, convenience to work, privacy, safety, accessibility, parking for vehicles and bicycles, and even bus services to public transport hubs, universities and airports are usually expected. Some tenants' requirements go beyond R&D. It usually depends on the availability of infrastructure and the necessary expertise. So it can be limited manufacture and sale of parts and components, fabrication and limited prototyping can happen. Usually what they're saying is that tenants are not into production in the tech park itself, but some tenants usually go on to limited levels of fabrication, prototyping and even manufacturing at times. In general, the precinct provides us some controls that tech parks usually establish when they work with tenants. High rent, making it not cost effective to do mass manufacturing. Alarms equipped buildings for safety during emergencies. Security teams and patrols are used. Permission required prior to installations and safety checks for heavy equipment such as cranes, etc. So the precinct actually, when it's talking about in general, before it starts talking about the company itself, it presents to us a few examples, real life examples that can actually happen. Quick summary on those. Engineering labs might need sufficient space to construct a full-sized prototype. Installation and operation of a crane or other heavy equipment. CAD users can send files to fabricators who can build their prototypes using 3D printing technology. And the electronics company might have a clean room which is used to manufacture limited quantities of products for sale. Certain examples that the precinct provides. So all of these things are possibilities that can occur within a tech park. Now we will focus on the Knowledge City Technology Park itself. It's a quoted company and the largest technology park in the country, in Advilland. Okay, so the location and geography. It's located close to the campus of a leading technology university, which is Capital City University, CCU. Park is not directly affiliated to the university, located within 1 hour drive of several other major universities. KCTP campus is located within a 30-minute drive from CCU. The campus is also 3 miles from the Capital City International Airport, and several large hotels within a short distance of KCTP for visitor, client, tenant, colleague accommodations, and these hotels offer convenient venues for meetings and conferences as well. And there are several other universities within a comfortable traveling distance of KCTP. So location or geographically, it looks like KCTP is at a very highly beneficial, highly strategic location with so many benefits. Talk about the infrastructure. There are 24 hectares of pleasant landscape grounds, 18 buildings varying in size from 17,000 to 18,500 square meters. And overall, it has 320,000 square meters of floor space. Not bad. It is the largest in Advilland. So the history, flotation and ownership. This was founded in 1986 by Advilland's Capital City University, floated in 1999. CCU owns 20% of KCTP. Flotation was motivated by CCU's desire to raise funds and to free KCTP to provide a sustainable commercial boost to Advilan's tech sector. And since then, 970 direct staff have joined the company. Currently, it has a 970 staff count. And the company's infrastructure has improved significantly, has achieved very high occupancy rates. Most tenants remain at KCTP for at least 2 years, while some tenants have occupied buildings for longer than 10 years. So the company has grown very fast, has acquired a lot of staff, and has maintained high occupancy rates. So as far as the pre-scene is concerned, the picture it is painting is that KCTP is a business for the moment doing really well. Let's quickly then take a look at the vision, mission, and values. Vision is to contribute to innovation in business. Mission is to offer an open strategic platform for the development of innovation, technology, and enterprise. The values, there are five: innovation, community, integrity, flexibility, and responsiveness. So these are direct extracts from the pre-scene, no summarization. Alright, now let's focus on KCTP's tenants and its relationship to the universities, including CCU and the others as well. KCTP has an international reputation for excellence in several areas, such as biotechnology and engineering material. It has a close working relationship with CCU, has developed good relationship with many of KCTP's tenants. Some tenants decided to base themselves at KCTP in order to develop contact with leading academics at CCU. It has even led to commercial funding of CCU research projects. A large number of work experience opportunities for CCU graduates have arisen, also employment opportunities, and many tenants who were previously academics at CCU have now shifted to applied research with fully commercial objectives. So this is CCU's connectivity to KCTP and even collaborations with other entities. What about other universities specifically? The board of KCTP is keen to develop as many potential academic links as possible. Historically, many KCTP tenants have successfully collaborated with KCTP tenants and universities other than CCU. So there have been collaborations among tenants and other universities historically as well. Universities in general host academic conferences, especially at the hotels, partly also to attract participants from KCTP's tenants to develop potentially mutually beneficial contacts. So even universities have a vested interest in attracting tenants. You know, usually for what? Money. So competition in Adviland, several major competitors. Anyway, the precinct says that Adviland has 27 major tech parks. So among these several, Sai Park is said to be the biggest or the major competitor, located approximately 15 miles from KCTP, not that far. And the campus is of similar size to KCTP campus as well. All right, we'll have to keep an eye on them. Okay, a focus on operations and management functions. They have 24-hour functions like health and safety, security, maintenance with emergency cover, information technology, and reception and telephone. General services or general functions: administration, legal, marketing, internal audit, landscaping and gardening, and KCTP business services. Now, what about the KCTP's campus? Let's focus toward its composition. It's a major hub offering global connections, enables KCTP's tenants to maintain close contact with business contacts and colleagues from all around the world. It is purpose-built with excellent connection to utilities like water, electricity, and data, with scope to be upgraded if needed. In theory, it can meet the needs of a small town. Wow, okay. With ample provision for tenants' foreseeable needs and maintains the grounds to a high standard. So this is a snapshot of the building composition. You can in detail spend time with the document. Ideally, take a look at or read the pre-scene and then understand that this is exactly what, in terms of the big picture, the KCTP's building composition is. There are three categories actually. Out of the 18 buildings, 15 are for sole occupancy to individual tenants. Two of them are for smaller entities with modest needs than sole occupancy. And one of the buildings is for KCTP itself. The 15 building space is actually large units because the requirement is this. Two of them are subdivided into smaller workspace for smaller entities. And KCTP's single building is located beside the visitor's entrance and the car park. So each of these three categories have their own set of details that have been provided, which quite differentiates the infrastructure itself, the composition of the building itself. And as we move along, as we understand the precinct, it is very important we have a good understanding of what each of these categories or what type of infrastructure each category has. Make sure that you spend some quality time understanding and remembering these. Then, what are the services that are available for tenants? Obviously, there's the transport for tenants that is offered by KCTP. KCTP has a minibus and driver that tenants can book to commute between the airport. There is general transport as well, where it has its own subsidized bus service linking KCTP's campus to the university and the business district. There is storage, access to a campus computer network facility, linked to a secure server with an off-site hot backup. And there are executive offices and the boardroom, usually can be hired by tenants when not being used by KCTP. And KCTP hosts some meetings and conferences at either KCTP or at the hotels. Many appreciate the fact that KCTP can provide these services for a fee. And as a support service, KCTP has its business services aspect. Under KCTP business services, there are a flexible range of services ideal for startups that are managed by technologists who don't really have any interest in, you know, doing the administrative work, and tenants can pay to subcontract aspects of their business. Aspects such as bookkeeping, preparing tax returns, and human resources management. Then a word about the marketing and brand management side. The staff is one experienced manager and one assistant. The two key responsibilities I extracted were, one is new customer acquisition, obviously for marketing, quite obvious. And the second is customer retention by liaising with existing tenants, etc. So knowing the customer, knowing what the customer wants, knowing what the existing tenants want, very crucial for successful marketing expectation management here. All right, the security department. So we all know by now that security is of paramount importance at KCTP. Due to confidentiality aspects of the tenant's work, KCTP undertakes detailed background checks on all of its staff. It is done through a section in the security department, usually on all new staff and on staff being promoted for sensitive roles, insisting on extensive pre-employment checks, references from previous employers, full history of employment, and documentary evidence. All of these are used. And there are two specialists in cybersecurity to oversee and manage the security issues associated with managing the company's IT systems. So they have taken significant measures. We don't know if they are perfect, but significant measures to ensure that security is at a very high level. Next, we will focus on the rental agreements, which are extremely important. By KCTP, these agreements are for generally 12 months. They can be rolled forward indefinitely from year to year. Tenants required to indicate intention 6 months before agreements end. And tenants are also required to make a substantial cash deposit before taking possession of the workspace. And the deposit is usually returned at the conclusion of the tenancy after settling all receivables and the restoration of the buildings or workspace. So this pretty much reduces the risk significantly for KCTP. In addition to this, of course, KCTP has taken significant controls, and they're not necessarily mentioned as controls, but what I did was I analyzed the pre-scene and extracted these as the key controls that the pre-scene has provided. Other than or apart from the principal risk register. So KCTP insists that tenants keep the exteriors of the respective buildings and surrounding area clean and tidy. Tenants are also required to restore their buildings to their original condition at the end of their tenancy. Must inform KCTP's health and safety department of all equipment that will be used. Tenants must permit KCTP to carry out regular safety inspections. And KCTP reserves the right to refuse installations and modifications. Tenants are free to make their own arrangements for data storage and communications if they want, but we still offer the service. And new tenants are vetted carefully, including rigorous financial checks. And just like some practical examples that were generally provided, even in specific terms to KCTP's discussion, the precinct provides some examples. One, some tenants install interior partition walls to provide separate spaces. Most install specialized equipment ranging from small air filters to small furnaces. One tenant recently installed an industrial laser, but there was a permission issue initially until the workspace was fitted with safety locks. And a tenant wished to replace a furnace used to create alloys with larger model, but was refused because this would have caused brownouts in the electricity supply to other buildings. These are some recent incidents that have happened, not very major, but indicate that KCTP is very careful. This is a snapshot of the board of directors. If you have already read the precinct, you know very well, or you know to a reasonable extent who the board are and the composition of the board itself. There are altogether four executive directors, E1, E2, E3 and E4. And ideally, including the chairman, there are five non-executives in KCTP's board. This is quite a unique position to be in. Sanjay is the CEO, leads the executive directors. Bill is Director Ops, Shireen is Director Finance, Chloe is Director HR, then Jules is the chairman, Jody, Rick, Rio and Professor Helga Kras are all the other NEDs. I have added a column for responsibility. So each director's key responsibilities have been summarized under this column and experience highlights have been provided for each director. That would be a complete snapshot of all the directors or KCTP's board of directors. Having a decent understanding and using these, because some of these experiences can be practically used when you're facing a particular situation in the variant. Say, for example, if there is a situation where a commercial property law is suddenly important, and there you can definitely put in this experience factor and say Rick Adamson, who is a non-executive director, can definitely be consulted in this space to get some advice, which is primarily the requirement that corporate governance dictates to have NEDs in a board. Next, we have a snapshot of the principal risk register that have been identified by the precinct. So security, turnover, health and safety, IT and cybersecurity, the risk impact has been presented with key mitigation measures that are currently in place. This is not a perfect picture. You can always have better risk mitigation elements. You can even, as we go along, as we analyze the precinct, we will even identify if there are any bigger risks to KCTP than these five. So under security, theft and vandalism and espionage, tenant turnover, ability to be a going concern, and the long-term survival of startups, because if tenants stop paying us back, we will have an issue. Health and safety, hazardous processes and practices can be followed by some tenants. IT operations being heavily dependent upon availability of servers, and of course cybersecurity, where tenants file confidential information regularly about various work they are involved in. So the risk mitigation elements are summarized here, which you can go through and even make judgments about whether they are the best whether all the risk mitigation aspects or actions have been taken, are there anything better they could have done. Then we have a quick snap on the KCTP's share price. So the price has been stable over the past 5 years. There have been dips around these time periods, August, September 2016, somewhere here, and a sudden dip even in July, August 2019. So the minimum price has been around $11, roughly here. The peak has been somewhere around March to April 2018, which has ideally been somewhere here at about $15.1 maybe. And as of the date we are receiving the pre-seen, or ideally the end of September, the price is almost sitting at about $8.14.1. That's pretty much a summary on the pre-seen image on the share price, which doesn't tell us much, but at least says that the company has resiliently maintained its price, which is indicative of its good performance as well. Not stellar performance, or else we would have seen some big hikes of the price. Take Tesla, for example. And on that note, we get to the news story summary. There are 6 news stories, and this time, as opposed to some of the more recent pre-scenes, the blogs section has been removed from the pre-scene. The 6 news stories, the first one, universities focus on knowledge exchange, where they talk about how previously universities were evaluated on the strength of teaching and research, but now universities usually are looking for even to promote internal professors and talent. They look for work that has actually some demonstrable application to the real world. They are less interested in the content and count of the papers. Application quality over quantity. The second news story talks about how top scientists can't build their own inventions. The complete news story uses this movie analogy, where we never see how a research lab output is converted to a gadget that the hero uses. So that is the portrayal here. They talk about, they even use an example, say that DNA sequencing research to usually increase yield is very time consuming, but then it usually gives way to a process more similar to cooking in a factory. So DNA sequencing, the final output, to get that output, the process is more like a cooking process in a factory rather than a lab research. The third news item talks about how simulation is now being revolutionized. Ideally, in a conventional world, in a traditional world, engineers would build a physical model of the respective design and would test them in a lab, then test it live. They give you an example of airplane wing testing, but now the same tests can be conducted virtually. So this virtual capability is highlighted in this news item. Softwares can be used to design and then tested by running the software through different simulations. So simulation capability has been recently capturing the market heavily. That is the idea they are trying to present with the third news item. Fourth news item is about 3D printing, which is taking off literally, apparently. They say that in a conventional, traditional sense, you had to do prototyping by using the idea of fabrication. So computer-aided design, CAD drawings were passed on to a fabricator to create physical object. But now with 3D printing, what has happened is that this technology can create relatively large objects and also can use a range of materials such as carbon fiber and even metal with increased versatility. It is fast as well. It is much faster. For example, an aircraft manufacturer could mail the CAD files of a printable component to a 3D printer on the other side of the world to print the component for immediate use. The fifth news item talks about quantum mechanics. It's this idea that as opposed to the binary concept of digital computers, when you say digital, You basically have this concept of one and zero or binary. Quantum mechanics and quantum mechanics powered computers usually can deal with much more complex scenarios, because when binary is being used, it means outcomes have to be certain. So for example, with quantum mechanics, they give you a beautiful example. Usually, if you want to decode an encrypted system, the conventional method is a brute force attack, where you're trying each key one at a time. But with quantum computing, the computer would try every possible combination at once and open the file instantly. As such, quantum mechanics and computers are expected to support the development of many new products, such as better medicine and lighter, stronger material. So the development process is also made much faster with quantum capabilities. And finally, the news item is about how green is the cloud. The simple summarization is that cloud computing has been effective. The researchers do not argue that cloud is inefficient. They are only saying that the energy savings associated with the use of cloud are usually overstated. So the idea they are trying to communicate is that the data transmission, right, you can definitely, what is happening is you're storing your data and the data processing is happening in a remote site somewhere that you don't even see. But that is all well and good. But what is actually happening is that the transmission of data from you to the remote site and the remote site to you, that is always happening. That is always live, or at least for the most part, it is happening. And that is heavily electricity and energy consuming. And that aspect has been understated. That is what they're trying to ask by the beautiful phrase, how green is the cloud? And with that, the SCS pre-seen summarization document is complete. We did go through the entire document, and I hope that when you look at that vast amount of information that the pre-seen has provided, this document will be a much lighter one to work with, and also much more efficient when you want to take down notes and annotate and even cut, chop, edit, write questions, attach your revision content, etc. I hope you put this to excellent use, as countless students have done before you. Good luck and thank you.